Hi there. I've done this short video to try and make clear how you wire up your lighting to your DCC loco. I tried to find a video or some information that would help me do this from being a complete beginner, and I didn't really find anything, so I thought it'd be useful if I set out what I've discovered, which will hopefully help you make some decisions on the sorts of lights that you need to buy and how to wire it up. So going back to the real basics, what I've done is I've converted a few of my old locos to DCC. So the first stage of any process is you need to get the decoder. And this is a decoder if you've never seen one before. This is a lens decoder, L-E-N-Z. And as you can see, it's basically a small circuit board with some wires coming out of it. And those wires are different colours and they have different functions. Now, this one here is a four-mode decoder, four-function decoder. And how that works in reality is that one of those functions is to drive the motor of the locomotive, obviously. And the other three drive three other functions. And I think I'm right in saying this, that those three functions are essentially a lighting. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the wires on this decoder, and I think this is pretty much the standard layout for decoders. There may be some changes in the colours, but hopefully I think this is more or less universal. Go through the colours, explain what they do, but more importantly explain how the lighting works, because as a beginner, my initial problem was to try to figure out what it was meaning by having lighting at the front and rear of a locomotive, when of course most standard locomotives will go in both directions. So what becomes the front becomes the back, and what happens. So hopefully this will clarify what that impact is if you are having the same trouble as me. So there's our decoder, colours coming out of the decoder, and this is a second hand one, as you can see, because the wires have been cut short. And basically the idea of this is I can show you where those wires go and what they do. So put that to one side. So here we have what is in essence the simplest layout. That is a enlargement of the decoder there. So I'll just put that down there so you can see the colours. The most standardised colours, I think, are from the rail pickup and the wires going to the motor, and I'll try and keep this as steady as I can, but from your railway lines you've got red and black which feed into the decoder, and they is obviously picked up normally through the wheels, and coming out of the decoder you've got six colour cables, wires. The two which are pretty much fundamental for any DCC layout are the grey and the orange, and they both go to the locomotive motor. So pick up from the railway lines into the decoder, and that comes straight out again into the motor. Okay, now the other ones are the ones we're really interested in. And on this decoder there are four colours. You've got a green, you've got a blue, you've got a white, which obviously I've shown as a black line here, and you've got a yellow. I think those colours more or less have a standardised function, and certainly on this layout the functions are as follows. Now the white wire, and I'll just show you this over here, the white wire from your decoder, it is usual that will go to the front lighting of your locomotive. And if you can see here, I've put down negative, and the reason for that will become clear later. So the white wire goes to the loco front. The yellow wire here, goes to the rear lighting on the locomotive. Again, I've shown negative coming into the light. And there is a final wire, which you probably can't see that clearly, this one here, which is green. And that is what's called an auxiliary light. So in essence, it could be anything you like. It can light up, and I've just given you a couple of examples there. You could use it to light up the cab, or you could light up the head code. Again, the green wire goes into the negative. The green wire is the negative going into the lamp. Now, in order to stop each of these lamps, so we've got three lamps here, basically, in order to stop the aggravation of having three separate wires coming out and going back to your decoder, the way you do it is all the lamps go back to a single wire, which is the blue one. So you may be able to see, but this is a blue wire here, and a blue wire here. These all come back via a same feed into the decoder. So that blue is a common return. And the convention is that the blue wire is the positive wire. So coming into these lights, you've got the negative wire, and coming out is a positive wire. The reason why that's important is because later on we'll talk about different types of lighting. And some lights are polarity dependent, and what that means is if you wire them up the wrong way, they won't come on. So that, in essence, is the very basic layout. Now, what's critical about this, which has caused me probably the most difficulty in trying to understand this from a beginner's point of view, is what happens when you've got the light on the loco front and then you reverse the direction of the loco. So that light then becomes the rear loco. In essence, it's quite simple. The lighting, the loco lighting, front and rear, it's turned on by you via a function on your controller, but in essence the sequencing of lighting is simply controlled by the direction of travel. So what that essentially means is if the locomotive front is this end and you set your controller so that this is the front of the locomotive, you turn the lights on, this light will come on, this light will go off. Or it just won't come on. So when you set the direction of your locomotive, this light will come on if this is the front of the travel. You reverse the direction of your locomotive on your controller, so you're not touching the lights at all, but as soon as you reverse direction of your controller, this light will come on and that light will automatically go off. And that, in essence, is the basis of it. Obviously, what that does mean is when you have lights on the front and the rear of your locomotive, whatever colour you happen to choose, and probably more or less you're going to choose white, when you reverse the direction of your locomotive, that light will come on, that light will go off. So in essence, you're going to have white lights on both ends, because if this was white and this was red, when the train was travelling in this direction, you'd have a white light on the front. And when you reverse the direction, you'd have a red light on the front, which wouldn't make any sense. So in its very basic form, you will have white lights at both end, and whatever direction the train goes in, that white light will come on. The other light, this one here, the auxiliary light, that again is controlled by you, but that is completely independent of any direction of travel. So it doesn't matter which way the locomotive goes, when you turn that light on, it will come on. So if you use it to illuminate your cab or your head code, it doesn't matter which direction the train is going, that light will come on when you turn it on via a function key. So that is the most simplest and straightforward way of doing your loco lighting. So this simple layout will have limited abilities for our locomotive, because we can only have one light at each end of the locomotive on at once. We're going to make this more complicated now, because what we really want is, for argument's sake, a white light at one end and a red light at the other end. We can do that, but we need to run more wires and have more lights. So we're now going to show you how we do that. So we're going to step it up now. Wiring's got more complicated, but the chip hasn't changed and the wires haven't changed. Now, if you can just see that there, I've said this is in series, because we've got two options now. We can wire this up in series, or we can wire it up in parallel. And that has an impact on the types of light that we would like to use and how we wire it up, which we'll talk about in a minute. So we've now stepped it up. Essentially, we've got the same ideas, but we've just made them slightly more complicated. So if we look at this white cable again, the white wire coming out of the decoder, that runs up to our front loco lamp again, but instead coming out via the blue cable, which is the return, we wire it in series to a red lamp at the rear of the loco, and then that is wired back into our blue wire as before, which comes back to the decoder. Similarly, for what we're terming as the rear lamp, which is the yellow wire. Yellow wire comes out of the decoder again, goes into our white lamp to the rear of the loco, comes out. Instead of going back by the blue, I've just shown it as a yellow and blue dotted line, goes into the front end red lamp, and that again comes back via the blue cable, a common cable to the decoder again. I've also shown here a slightly more complicated variety of auxiliary lamping, again from the green wire coming out of the decoder. This time I've showed it going to both ends of the locomotive. Could be the cab, it could be the head code, whatever we decide we want to do to it. So again, coming into a lamp at the front end of the locomotive, not necessarily outside, more than likely going to be inside, via a common cable going to the rear cab or rear head code, and again that ultimately comes back to the decoder via the blue cable. So we've just created more wires because we've now got two lamps for each end of the locomotive. So what does that actually do? Well, basically, very simply, what it does is, as we said in the more simple version, the lamping coming on will be dependent on the direction of travel. But what we've done now is if you can see, we've basically wired up a white and a red lamp on the same cable, and we wind up a red and a white lamp on the same cable. So what does that do? Well, basically, this is really the best result we want for simple directional lighting. When we set the direction of our locomotive and we turn the front stroke rear function on, what we'll end up getting is we will have a white lamp on at this end and a red lamp on the back. When we reverse the direction of the locomotive, those two lamps will go out, and what we'll have is a white lamp on the rear of the locomotive and a red lamp on the front. So in other words, all that essentially means is we now have whatever direction of travel the locomotive going in, we'll have a white light on the front, a red lamp on the back. We change direction, we then got a white lamp on the back and a red lamp on the front, obviously depending on which direction of travel, whether you want to call it the front or back. Or perhaps the better way to describe it would be number one and number two end, but there we go. As before with the auxiliary lamping, the direction of travel is irrelevant. These lamps will stay on. And once we've turned them on with our function key, those lamps will stay on, both ends, and therefore, whatever we decide to use them for, cabs, head codes, whatever, they will always be on. So both those lamps will come on. With these lamps, they will be either on or off, depending on the direction of travel. The purists would say that's probably not sufficient, because obviously if we have a locomotive hauling a train, the red lamp wouldn't be on the back of the locomotive, because the red lamp would be on the back of the last wagon or coach, whatever. As I'm a beginner, I'm not too concerned about that at the moment, but I believe that is addressable by having an additional decoder to change that function. But we're not in the realms of that yet, or I'm not in the realms of that yet, so I'm quite happy with this solution. So this is ultimately what I've wired up my very first attempt, which you'll see a bit later. And essentially what that does is what I needed to do. In the direction of travel, we'll have a white lamp on the front and a red lamp on the back. And whenever I change the direction of the locomotive, those will switch around easy. So this is what I've called a series layout. Now the reason why I've shown this in series is because that has an impact on the way that we... or what lamps we decide to use. In a series circuit, you share the voltage between your lamps. So these two lamps here are sharing the voltage, which I should have said earlier, is I think it's correct in saying it's 12 volts. So we have 12 volts functions coming out of the decoder, and these lamps will share that 12 volts. In essence, what that means is if these lamps are rated at 12 volts, they will be half as bright because the voltage is being shared between the two lamps. Now that to me is an advantage in some respects, especially with the auxiliary lighting, because we're going to talk about lamps in a minute, and I tend to find a lot of the lamps are far too bright for a realistic situation. They're just enormously bright. So the advantage we've got of putting these lamps in series is we share the load between the lamps and they start to become dimmer or more realistic, perhaps, is a way to say it. There is a problem with that in some respects, which we'll talk about, and that is the type of lamp. Some of the lamps need a minimal voltage or minimum voltage to actually work, and if we try to drop that too much to make it too dim, the lamp will just go out. It won't even be illuminated. So this shows it as a series layout that we have. If we don't want to deal with sharing voltages between lamps, and for argument's sake, let's just say we've configured our system so that we have lamps that can handle 12 volts no matter what, we can change this layout into a parallel series. It's just a question of reordering the wiring, and I'll just show you that briefly. So this is in essence exactly the same thing as before. All we've done now is we've put the wires into a parallel formation. So every lamp is now receiving the full 12 volts. It's not that 12 volts isn't being shared. So let's have a look at that. So again, we've got a white cable coming out of the decoder, which, as we say, is going to function our front lamps. So there it comes out there. But in this time, rather than sort of daisy chaining between two lamps, we've got two separate wires. So one's running to the front, one's running to the rear, and they're both travelling back via the blue wire. Same for the rear lighting coming up via our yellow wire. At that point, it splits, and we've got separate feeds going to the front and rear lamps, and again, they are returning via the blue. And the final one is the auxiliary function, which is the green wire comes up, it splits into two at that point, it feeds both lamps, and both lamps return via the negative, via the blue wire. So coming in as negative, going out as positive. The blue is always a positive return, and as I said before, there's an important aspect of that which affects the types of lamp which we want to use, which we're now going to talk about. So the first bulb we're going to talk about is an ordinary tungsten filament lamp. Now, these have got increasingly smaller over the years, to the point where they are starting now to get usable in things like model locomotives. Still, they're still quite bulky, I suppose. That's the tip of my pen compared to the size of the lamp. Now, with tungsten filament lamps, the advantage, I suppose, is that they are completely independent of the polarity, the positive or negative wires coming in. So just to show you my setup here, I've got a little 12 volt power supply here that's going into these two wires, which are red and black, and it doesn't matter which way round I put these on this little lamp here, it will still light up. So it's completely independent of the polarity. So now I'm going to put some voltage into this lamp. Now, the advantage of a tungsten filament lamp is they are proportional to the voltage. These are 12 volt rated lamps. And what that essentially means is the more voltage I put into it, up to 12 volts, the brighter the lamp gets, which is good for us because it means if we want a fairly dull looking lamp, for argument's sake, in a cab, you wouldn't normally expect to have a cab illuminated with like huge, great fluorescent tubes. You tend to have I guess the illumination just from the cab instruments mostly, so we can try and match the look of the lamp compared to its function, and tungsten filament lamps help us do that because they are purely related to the voltage. So I'm now going to turn up the voltage and we can start there. It's just coming on there, and that's about 3 volts at the moment that's getting. I'll put it up to full voltage, which is 12 volts these are rated at. So that's now at full voltage. And you can see as I drop the voltage down, that lamp will decrease in brightness. And they're quite a warm lamp as well, which obviously may suit, certainly if we're trying to mimic things like oil lamps, that sort of type of stuff. So that has the advantage, and it's quite simple to do. As I mentioned earlier, we've got two ways to wire up our lamps, and that is in series or in parallel. And the advantage of a tungsten filament lamp is, of course, that we just string them together in series and they share the voltage. So that's 12 volts there. if I put two of these together, they would be sharing 6 volts, or they would share the 12 volts between them to be 6 volts. So then if I put two together, it would be that bright. And if I put 4 together, it then halves it again. So we quite a good way of making our lamps dimmer and brighter to suit. The other way we can do that, obviously, is using resistors. But the problem with tungsten filament lamps, and I suppose with resistors as well, or the main failure we got, is that they do get warm, and we don't really want these tiny little bulbs getting red hot when they're right next to the plastic shell of your locomotive. I suppose the other failure they have is obviously their longevity. Once we've wired up our locomotive and got it working, what we don't really want is in 6 months we have to change the bulb because it's blown. So there is that problem with the voltage. So that is a tungsten filament lamp. The next up is a light emitting diode, or a LED. These are probably the most common lights we're going to come across. They do come in various shapes and sizes. This is, if you can just see that this one's got a rounded head, but they tend to be quite different in how you can buy them, flat head. But they do share a sort of fairly common problem, and that is they're quite directional. If you look at them from the side on like this, you might see that there's not actually much you can see, but when you look at them onwards, as it were, like down the barrel of a gun, they're very, very bright, and that's probably one of their problems. They're so bright, they're not really suitable for some of the functions, which, as I said earlier, makes us try to make them slightly dimmer. So here we have a LED. Let's put some voltage in this. That's about 3 volts, and it's now come on. One of the things about LEDs, and this is what I was saying earlier about the wiring up in series, is if the voltage drops too much, it won't just get dimmer, it'll just go out completely. So if we drop the voltage too much, and we could get that, for argument's sake, by trying to wire up too many LEDs together, they just won't come on. It'll just be permanently off. So this one's coming on about 3 volts or so. So let's get it up to its maximum brightness, which these ones are actually rated at 12 volts. So that's now at 12 volts. And as you can see, the light, when it's side on, is pretty bright. But when you look down the barrel, it gets really bright. So that's just something to bear in mind. And there's just one thing I would say there. I've probably caused a bit of confusion. And these aren't 12 volt LEDs. I think practically every LED you can buy is 2 volts. The reason why these are 12 volts is because you probably can't see it very clearly, but actually in that black shroud there's a resistor. So when I bought these, I bought them as 12 volt LEDs, but in essence the light part of that is only a 2 volt, and I can run it on 12 volts because there's a resistor in there. Now I just bought these as 12 volt LEDs because I didn't really know what I was buying, and I thought I'd give it a go. So they have got some use, but bear in mind that if you buy just the bare LED, it's normally 2 volts. Now, if I had a 2-volt LED on there and I put 12 volts through it, it would just blow it up, so it would completely destroy it. So this resistor is making this useful for us because we can run 12 volts straight through it. So as I say, they are depending on the polarity. You've got the red and black cables here going into my red and black cables from my transformer. If I reverse those, that LED will just go out completely. So that has a bearing on how we wire them up. This is the final one I want to talk about. I haven't wired these up yet because they are amazingly fiddly, but they are absolutely minute. And each of those little white rectangles you can see on that black band, try and focus it in, is an LED, a LED. It's a surface mount LED, that's called. A tiny, tiny little circuit board with a LED on it. I'll try and master how to solder them onto some wires so that it can illuminate them, but ultimately they are probably the best form of lighting we can have for locomotives because they're tiny, absolutely tiny, and therefore they're not going to be huge great things stuck in a plastic casing of our locomotives. We can put them really neatly and smallly, but they are absolutely minute. These ones are actually red, funny enough. You can't tell that from just looking at them, and there are some white ones here, but you can't tell. But you can see the size of them; they're absolutely minute. These are actually stuck in this little bit of black stuff to stop them being lost. Essentially, when I peel that little plastic film off in front, they'll fall out as a tiny little grain of sugar, for want of a better word. So we're trying one of those up, but essentially exactly the same as the bigger LED I was showing you earlier. But as you can tell from these are just the LED themselves. There's no resistor there, so they will work on about 2 volts. So if we put that on our 12 volt supply, that would instantly blow them up. They would just go out instantly and never come back on again. So we need to protect them with resistors, which perhaps we'll talk about in the future, but at the moment the purpose of this was really just to show you how you need to think about wiring up your locomotive so you can get the lights to come on back and front, and the types of lamps and LEDs that you can buy, which you can able to do. I basically started from scratch with very little knowledge, and I've worked my way through the various stages. I have wired one loco up, which we'll see in a minute, but that's it for the moment. Hope you spin.
So now we're
somehow
looking at a surface mounted LED. It's actually held between the two ends of the tweezers. You probably can't even see it. I've put that pound coin there to give you an idea of the size. These work on, as I said earlier, these work on 2 volts. It's actually probably between about 2 and 3 volts. So I'm going to put some voltage in this one now. That's 1 volt going in there, so it's not actually illuminated yet at 1 volt. That's 2 volts, still nothing. 2.5, so it's coming up, it's coming on. There's about 2.2, I'd guess 2.2 to 2.5 volts. It's probably fully bright now, so I don't want to go any further than 2.5 volts because it'll probably just blow it up. So that's a surface mounted LED. Now what I should have said earlier is that there are different sizes of these things. These are probably the smallest, and so you could probably buy a slightly larger sized one. Probably about 2 or 3 millimeters by 2 or 3 millimeters. That would be easier to work with and easier to fit, I'd imagine, but time will tell.
So just to find a little sequence where we can actually see this in action, good old-fashioned Hornby class 47, which I've converted to DCC and added some lighting. So this is the first attempt I've had at lighting. I'm using a Hornby select controller, and on this controller, function 1 turns on, as you can see there, the head codes, and there are one at each end, so that's being powered by 12 volt incandescent lamps, which I've put 2 in series, so they're half as bright, which I think gives the light level just about right. In fact, there's a little bit of light bleed around there, which I can sort out. And on this controller, function 0 turns on the front end of this cab light and the rear end of the back, the red lamp. So if I move the loco slightly, now if I reverse the direction on the controller, you can see that the red light automatically comes on the back and the front lamp will automatically come on at the front, so I don't need to change the lights at all. I can just keep changing the direction of travel, and the light will automatically configure. Okay, that's it. I hope that's handy.